That Bleach Thousand Year Blood War Arc Trailer 2 dropped and people are still going insane about it after many days, including myself. And there was a lot to talk about, things that I'd love to talk about separately, but there'd just be a bunch of spammy videos and probably a bunch of nothing as well of things that I wanted to talk about, which is going to be talked about in this video instead. Is Tokenade in there? Is Bambia as sexy and going to be included? What are the comparisons compared to the other trailers? What is the release date and the time slot, and what do I think of all these things? Where do I think the Bleach anime is going to be ending for season 2? And many more things that I want to talk about in general. So sit back, relax, hit that click and subscribe button, because we're going to be talking about all things exciting about Bleach, Core 2, and my overall opinions on many different subjects. With that being said, stick around and find out. Now, I'm pretty sure I've watched this trailer just as much as you guys, and we've gotten a really full scope of how it's going to look, X, Y, and Z. Now, truth be told, I think it's going to look a teeny weeny bit different than what the final result's going to be, and I'll explain why. But overall, the trailer in and of itself was really fun and enjoyable, and of course, it's not in any chronological order like it tries to be sometimes with the whole Matsumoto and Toshiro stuff, and then going into Soifon. It goes a little bit chronological, but then it jumbles everything. I'm not going to talk about the dialogue within this trailer because I feel like there's nothing really much to really specifically talk about, unlike the last trailer that we got where Shinji did have a voice line which was very suspect, and pretty much everything that we thought was going to happen actually happened within this PV. But other than that, there's nothing in the trailer dialogue anyway worthy that I personally find interesting or fascinating. I know for a lot of people that are anime onlys who don't really know much about Bleach Thousand Year Blood War in and of itself, the successor for Uryu and Yuha is probably really shocking and really like discussion worthy for them. But honestly, that isn't that interesting because it's like episode one type of stuff of season two, and there's not really much to go on to. So first and foremost, what do I think of how Bleach is looking so far? Of course, people are going to talk about the red sky. People are going to love it or they're going to hate it. And I always said, just like in Core 1, because we had some, you know, Hueco Mundo green, and we had Hueco Mundo blues. We had the Quincy Palace, which was all blue. We had the Soul Society, which had this grey effect. And people complained then as well. And when the series actually came out and we actually get to see these episodes in full context, people didn't really actually care about the colors that much, and kind of their criticism, they got adapted and used to it. And I feel like this is going to be one of those red sky moments where people are like, oh, I don't know about that, but once the episode is going and you've been, you know, instilled into it more than 5 minutes, you're gonna get used to that environment and the kind of scenery that you're involved in. I have no problem with the red sky. I think it fits. I've seen Persona, I've seen some Evangelion, I've seen this red sky, I've even seen all of JoJo Part 4 where all the sky was literally yellow. So this is interesting. I'm very fascinated to see how this is going to go. I did see some things on Twitter of some people adding some textures into the red sky, which of course looks good as well. So, but I don't, honestly, there's something telling me that nothing's finished in terms of like the creative decision of like the backgrounds, especially the sky. So I'm going to wait and see to see what happens. But I do want to talk about the previous PV and this PV and talk about a little bit of the comparison shots. There was two shots that have been changed slightly from the last PV. Well, the only two shots that we see as well, which is a Mayuri one, which is on screen right now, as you can see. And of course, a Basby one. And of course, I do believe that whenever this PV was made, we're probably going to see more, you know, improvements or adjustments as the series goes on. And of course, hopefully as well in the Blu-rays, if anything. If it needs to be touched upon. So to talk about these comparisons, of course, the lighting differences for Basby is a lot better. And of course, the texture effect on Mayuri just, I don't know. I really, really dig that CRT TV effect. It gets me going. I don't know why. It just hits different. And of course, the background's changed and Nemu finally got some time to shine. And beautiful, beautiful. Everybody give Nemu her flowers because she deserves it. Next thing I want to talk about is the release date of the anime. And I found this very interesting from a business perspective, because we've gone from Monday to a Saturday, especially a Saturday night at 11 o'clock. And why this is huge and why this change is very significant is that, you know, to have a weekday from a Monday to even Wednesday, Wednesday, not so much Thursday or Friday. Those are your TV time slots or your TV days where it's a little less expensive. It's more of a safe kind of time slot to go for. Advertisers are more willing to take a bit of a risk on, because those are usually the dates or days per se that people aren't really going to be watching TV as much, and it's going to be like your salarymen, whatnot. It's not going to be your kids or anything like that. It's going to be like your average, you know, TV enjoyers. So the fact that they moved it over to a Saturday means, one, it did very well and boosted off the confidence of advertisers that, you know, advertised on the Monday, that they believe that on a Saturday time slot, Bleach will do well enough to garner the viewing figures for to keep the advertisers happy on TV Tokyo. And that is fascinating. That is really, really good. I mean, the ideal time slot is like 8 to 9 o'clock on a Sunday morning where all the kids are up, but it's Thousand Year Blood War Arc. That's not going to happen. So you have to understand that this is big. Like a Saturday time slot close to midnight, very good news for Bleach, especially on a money basis, in terms for the advertisers. And everything moving forward for TV Tokyo's confidence and any Plex's confidence within Bleach, because the bigger it gets, the more popular it gets, the more that we get later on, so, and the more investment goes into the series as well. So I did want to touch upon that very briefly, because I do think it is important that people are just going to brush past a little bit. Next thing I want to talk about is, where do I think the Thousand Year Blood War arc is going to end in terms of Core 2? And I did get a bit hesitant, but I'm going to stick with my guns on this one. Bear in mind, Core 1's PV didn't really give us kind of an idea of where, you know, it was going to end either, granted. But, you know, as far as I'm concerned and what I'm thinking, I still think it's going to end at, like, the invasion of the Soul Palace. A lot of the things within this arc are things that happened before that, even Ichigo turning up in his new gear. I think a lot of it is going to be padded out with a lot of training scenes, especially with Ichigo. And I want to talk about the colors later, but there's going to be a lot of training scenes, Ichigo included, as well as the extra fights that Kubo said he was going to give us, as well as some Sternritter extra filler moments as well, that I guess we could say, because they are kind of filler-ish, because they just changed that corridor scene with Basby flipping out about Uryu being the accessor. Instead of it being in a corridor of like the Wotherwell, or whatever you want to call it, has now been changed to the Quincy table, which should be a round table. I agree with whoever said that in my last comment section, for which I think is a better change, if I'm quite honest with you. As well, I did like the chimes of the clock tower bell that was going on throughout the rest of the PV as well. And I like this because it's just a nice callback to how long all that time ticking before Ichigo can get from the Soul Palace to the Soul Society to help them out. So the chime bells, it's kind of like the saviors coming type of thing. So like, yeah, there's the separation with Uryu and Ichigo, and of course that there's that theme. And I still don't think it's going to be Ichigo versus Uryu as the original fight. I don't see where in the manga it can fit, and that's just my I'm standing very strongly on that. I don't think it's Ichigo and Uryu at all. With that being said though, I do think with the separation, I do think having Ichigo as the savior and having those chime bells go in the PV, I do think it was a really nice touch. And that's where I think it is going to end. It's like you have this savior thing, it's going to build up, this whole arc's going to build up to that savior thing, right? And then I feel like that arc's going to end where the separation happens between Ichigo and Uryu, where he finds out that Uryu sided with Yuha, and then obviously he tries to stop him and it fails. So that's the kind of theme that I'm getting, and that's why I say it's going to end at the invasion of the Soul Palace. And I think the only thing that threw me off slightly was the laboratory that Urahara had made with Mayuri to get to the Soul Palace, but considering there was no like water or that spirit energy like orb thing where all the Soul Reapers had to get together and make the gate, so to say, this is very early, clearly very early in production, or maybe that isn't really going to get utilized anytime soon, it's just there. That's the only thing that kind of made me question about it, but I'm still gonna stick to my guns of where I think it's going to end. Of course, maybe we should talk about Tokinada, but before we get onto that, I do want to talk about the Bambietta sex scene. And yes, I know it's not really a sex scene per se, but I think it is a great demonstration of introducing the Bambies, which I know that Kubo wanted to give more screen time to the Bambies, so I don't see why they would remove this. And bear in mind that when the meeting happened with Basby and the round table, the table scene, whatever, that happens before the Bambietta moment where she gets a Quincy guy and then like offers to smash him, and then obviously she kills him, and then the Quincy girls come and then they give their own introductions. I still think that that is plausible, and the reason I say this too is because Bambietta is talking while the screen is almost completely red, and usually you go for like a red dark tone when you're in a room by yourself yourself or like you have a room with light in, usually red is usually a good kind of color to go for to indicate that you're in a room, especially if you're doing like sexy time. Having red to be very like seductive is like, it makes sense, right, to have Bambietta in a room where it's red and then it looks like she's talking to someone and it's possible that the Quincy girls came in and then she responded to him. Again, I'm not going to be fooled by the voice lines within the trailer because I do think they're placed there for a reason, and that's to misjudge you, but I do think, you know, where is Bambietta at that time? What position is she in? So I am holding out, and I do think, you know, the sex scene or whatever you want to call it, right? Which I believe she didn't have sex with the geezer because he's not him and he can't please her. And, you know, that's where I come in. But if I was a Quincy, obviously, I don't know, maybe I can fix her. But still, she ain't going to kill you if you've got good dick. And unfortunately, this guy didn't even get the dick game out. It looks like, oh, look, I'm just going from the manga panel. And this is why I want it animated, because from the manga panel, I've had this debate for a long time. In the manga panel, in the colored manga, she has one titty out, which means one titty over the bra, and obviously she readjusts her skirt. So it implies to me that my man's four gameplay is really bad. Like he probably fondled, he probably like fed the cat, wasn't good enough. Bambietta was like, nah, this man can't even please me with his hands, let alone his trousers. And that's why the geezer still had his trousers on. That's why he was topless, because the four game was mid. And I've been, you know, having this debate with people for ages, so that's kind of why I want it. But regardless, it's not a fan servicey scene as like the Rukia scene was, or the Misaki scene, so to say, because you can tell those without really those scenes necessary. But for this one, it goes to show how pent up Bambietta is. He brings out her character and her personality a little bit, her viciousness, and the Bambi girls and their little bit of their personality and their interactions, you know, with Latoto calling Bambietta a slut, for example. You know, it's those little interactions which make these characters have depth, whether you like it or not. You know, this builds character. So I don't see how they can have that opportunity to do it at the round table. Let's talk about Toki Nada. I mean, besides the fact that, I mean, ultimately, the author basically gave us the green light and the big thumbs up towards, you know, it being Toki Nada and it looking like Toki Nada. It pretty much is Toki Nada. And I was saying this when I was streaming the live reaction. People need to realize that Toki Nada, this is the only point in the story of Core 2 of which he can appear. So if anyone's read the light novels, or you played the BBS game, Bleach Brave Souls game, or anything in between, you will know that after Ichigo evaporated the sea, Toki Nada, who is a royal family member, came down, took advantage of the sea or the ocean being cleared so he could go into this secret basement that Mayuri had and pick up this lost or secret hidden Zanpakuto, which Namaya didn't want getting out. And it's quite interesting that in the flashbacks, you see that this water is kind of rising up through each image. So at first it's like down to his knees and then it goes up towards like his chest a little bit. A coincidence, but it's a very convenient coincidence for it to happen. So again, the big long coat, or the captain's coat, not even a captain, but like a robe, a royal robe, and then of course holding a sword, which is it's not going to be the Soul Kings, is it? Because like, I don't even think Namaya existed right there to even create the Zanpakuto in the first place when the Soul King existed. Maybe I'm assuming, but to have a hold one singular sword, to have the water rise as the ocean is replenishing itself, and to have it in this weird flashback, and to be the only arc of which Toki Nada could be foreshadowed or introduced. I say foreshadowing because it might foreshadow Can't Feel Your Own World later on after the Thousand Year Blood War arc. That's why I say foreshadowed. It would be the only time for the staff to be able to put him in, right, as an Easter egg. For all those coincidences to suddenly come out now, seems to me that it's Toki Nada, especially if the author of Can't Feel Your Own World literally basically gave the thumbs up for it. So, I mean, it's basically Toki Nada. Like, you just, and that's fantastic. I'm very excited. Of course, I hope it's just a little tease. It's just a little feeler, a little blue ball, you know. I hope it's something like that and doesn't really go further, because I hope it's just setting up the foundations for Can't Feel Your Own World, and that would be amazing, because I do believe you can't end the Thousand Year Blood War series without that prelogue of the Can't Feel Your Own World novel. But that's just me. We'll see if Kazui or Ichikaze's character design sheets get kind of leaked towards Core 4, because if they do, then we have to might have another discussion, but still, nonetheless. So yes, Tokenada, and of course, and then finally the Soul King, the Soul King Sin, or the flashback, or whatever you want to call it. To me, I believe that this is the Soul King interacting with Ichigo. You know, he's finally come to terms with everything. He's finally accepting all of the spiritual energy that he has inside of him, which is the great use of colors, because it's very symbolic, actually. Each of the colors representing each spiritual pressure of like Hollow, Shinigami, Quincy, Fullbring, Human, all these different symbolic colors that are forming together of what basically makes Ichigo Ichigo, is finally being accepted and endorsed. And again, the training arc is really nice, especially with that shrine effect too, because, you know, Ichigo just does randomly come in and save the day and help people. So it would be nice to have a little bit more depth to his character, rather than be like, oh, I got some new swords, me strong now, right? So it would be nice to see him go through that internal newfound power, so to say. But yeah, in terms of the Soul King, the reason why I say this is the Soul King talking to him is because you have some people like Kurinji, which says, oh, I know why the Soul King like wants us to help that boy Ichigo. And then Ichibei also acts like he's talking to the Soul King, or like communicating with him. So it does seem like the Soul King in essence is being able to telepathically talk to Squad Zero members. And in saying that, he's talking to Ichigo as well. Again, the Soul King is the creator of Soul Reapers, Quincy's, all that junk, right? He's the father of everything. So, you know, for him to be able to communicate with Ichigo is not that far-fetched. So I'm very interested to see that, because that's very new to especially us manga heads. I'm very excited with everything that's gone down. It was such a fantastic trailer with amazing soundtracks thrown in there. The remixes of old OG Bleach songs, as well as, again, the opening soundtrack. I'll have to wait to see how that goes down. But overall, and of course, I've already talked about Shinji and his Bankai in a last video that didn't do so well. So go check that out over here on the screen in the link in the description down below. But also, I do want to mention something fairly interesting. And that is Hyorimaru has a voice actor being thrown into the credits. And this is potentially pretty interesting, because I'm not going to say that that's going to be the 1v1 fight and that's Toshiro versus Hyorimaru. But it could be fairly interesting. And again, I haven't actually gone back to reread how Toshiro gets to use his ice powers in Shikaigen. If it isn't explained in the manga, which I'm probably, from the top of my head, assuming that it's not, it would be absolutely fantastic for Toshiro to talk to Hyorimaru. And because again, you can't really get rid of, like, sure, you can get rid of the Bankai or seal it, but you can't really seal the soul. And the Asuchi and the Zanpakuto are like, the soul is like one in the same, like, you know, that 1% of Hyorimaru is still in his soul, obviously, because he's using ice powers with his Shikai. But so to have that little bit of extra depth with Hyorimaru, maybe, you know, that there is a fight, or maybe there is like a conversation, I think that is such an amazing little added touch that maybe will be significant or not. But still, even if it's fan service, it'd be cute as hell. And I can't wait to see that either. So tell me your thoughts in the comment section down below of what you think of all of this information. That being said, you guys, of course, have this fine day behind us, and hit that like and subscribe. It really helps out the channel, and share it, because views. You guys, of course, have this fine day behind us, and as always, people, peace out.